can jump right in and say that I am an ENTJ directing lion. My true colors are green, orange, blue, gold, and then according to BuzzFeed, everyone has a Disney song that matches their personality, and mine is I'll Make a Man Out of You from Mulan.
Wow.
Okay. Cute. Okay, so digging a little deeper into that introduction, I grew up and I have a kind of an obsession with leadership typology quizzes and personality assessments. Growing up, I was always playing those little cootie catcher games or playing MASH with my friends and trying to plan my future based on what member of One Direction I was supposed to end up with. So then once I became a student leadership assistant, I was kind of introduced to a whole new world of different leadership typology and personality assessment tests. So, ENTJ. And this is actually one of the rarest types of females. It's less than 2%. So some of the strengths, and here, is it like a little, is there like a lighty thing? A light?
I don't think so.
Okay, that's fine. We can all see. So like here we see this like beautiful little graphic of this nice lady talking to her employee here. And then if you can look at the strengths, and the strengths of ENTJ is efficient, energetic, and self-confident. But then you look at the strengths, and we notice that these workers are far less happy than prior. And you see that the weaknesses include poor handling of emotions and cold and ruthless. So digging a little deeper into that, their obsession with efficiency makes ENTJs incredibly insensitive in pursuing their goals. Ooh. All right. So then we look at true colors. In the true color spectrum, it kind of assigns you to, there's four different personalities that are assigned these four different colors. So you get a spectrum of your color, and then the color that is your brightest color is the ones you identify with most, while the color that is your least brightest or the dullest color is the one that you don't really attribute to as much. So my brightest color, green, is very logically driven and a very independent thinker, whereas blue, which I scored really low on, emotionally driven and sympathetic, sensing a pattern. And then finally we have Use It, which is one of my personal favorites, leadership psychology quizzes, and if I get you for long enough, I'll probably make you take it, even though I probably already know what you are. And then our four options here is the cautious eagle, the steady koala, the interacting porpoise, and then the directing lion. So if anyone wants to take a guess at what I might be, I am a directing lion. So the directing lion is usually the person asking what, and it's really the critical thinker who is trying to get the task done in the most efficient way possible. They strive for immediate and tangible results, and they usually display a very high self-confidence outwardly. And then also included, they downplay feelings and relationships. So with all of this, it's pretty easy to tell that I am not much of a people person. I'm an extremely logical and task-oriented person, and I think that efficiency is extremely important. So with all of this, based on like all these leadership typology things that I was learning a lot more about myself, and I started to portray these characteristics a little bit more effectively and more intentionally. So I kind of created this public image that I wanted other people to see me as. I was this independent and confident, driven female leader. So I have these snapshots of what I wanted people to see of me. I was this leader, I was this confident person. I'm a passionate person who really believes in advocating for social change and helping others. I'm an outgoing person, someone who's always a friendly smile on campus or doing the absolute most and running around and trying to do as many things as possible in my day-to-day life. But then also, I was trying to have this idea that I had no feelings. I began to see emotions as a weakness. I thought that if I turned my feelings and my emotions off, I would be stronger as a person. I thought with fewer vulnerabilities, I would be able to keep more people away and prevent them from seeing the true me. So I was effectively shutting out my emotions, and then when it came to establishing relationships, I was extremely cautious about what I was letting people know about me. I thought that if I could carefully select what information people were learning about me, they would like me more, and that if they knew too much about me, they would begin to see me differently. My persona meant a lot, so I built a lot of walls to keep people out so I could control what kind of parts of me that they saw. So my friendships and work relationships were relatively surface level, but when it came to romantic relationships, my fear of forming relationships became my identifier. I was Hannah, the single friend, Hannah, the confident woman who was gonna take over the world and didn't need a man. But in reality, it was because I just wouldn't let anyone actually get close to me. I didn't want people to know anything about me. My singleness wasn't part of some pledge to celibacy or a feminist anthem. I was just too careful about what information I was revealing about myself and not letting people get close. So talking about feelings was not my favorite thing. I rarely showed emotions, and if I did accidentally let a secret or a personal thought slip, I would act as if it never happened and immediately shut myself down. I truly believe that by shutting people out, I was making myself stronger. So then one night, as I'm developing a relationship with someone who's a little bit closer to me and happens to be someone that's very close to me now, I'm having a late night kitchen conversation with one of my really good friends. And suddenly my walls, my emotional walls, are starting to break down, and my friend starts asking very prying questions about a developing relationship. And I quite literally ran out of the room. I physically sprinted from the room to avoid answering any questions having to do emotions, because the thought of any conversation with slightly emotional undertones had me in a panic. The fact that someone wanted me to be vulnerable with them was absurd, but the fact was that I really couldn't even be vulnerable with myself. I had portrayed this image of being this independent and powerful woman, that my reputation that was so important to me, that I was scared that if I became vulnerable with myself, that other people would figure these things out about me, but that I would start to figure these things out about me. So it's taken a lot of time and a lot of persistence from some very important people in my life, but this year my emotional walls have finally started to crumble. It was a slow process, and from time to time I still retreat back in my shell and try to keep people away after divulging a little bit too much information, so all of y'all are in the secret now, great. However, I've grown a lot in both my personal and professional life. I recognize now that vulnerability in relationships isn't actually a weakness, but a strength. And being more open and willing to share things about myself has made me a stronger person, because I'm able to acknowledge that not only am I not this perfect person that I've been trying to convince people that I am, but that it's okay to be who I truly am. And while it's important that other people see the goofy side of me and the side that does make mistakes, it is more important that I embrace that part of myself while still feeling confident. So regardless if I am acting very professional in any manner, or if my quirky personality is taking center stage, I have grown more confident and comfortable with myself as a result of embracing vulnerability, and with both myself and with others. So thank you, especially to the people who have been extremely persistent and helped me chip away at the walls that have been patient with me on my journey from cautious to cared for.